So hello everybody, nice to see old faces and new faces at our second day of the conference about the future of music. And we will have our first panel of music professionals, as we organize this event in such a way that yesterday there were mainly academic papers and today we will have voices from the industry, so to speak. And before I very briefly introduce our panelists, let me introduce myself, although probably quite a number of you know me. I'm one of the organizers of this conference and I work at the School of Humanities and Social Sciences. And my main area is film history, but also I do research on music. And now, very briefly, our panelists. So I start with David Jones, who had just talked before. So I'm sure most people now know who you are, but you are basically a specialist of royalties representing the institution,
Peers
for Music. And after him we see Colin Appleby, who is a musician, organizer of festivals and music promoters. And then we have Matt Parsons, who represents Ditto Music, and I hope you will explain later what it is.
Sure.
And then we have Rudy Kidd, who is an entertainment industry lawyer. Then we have Matt Wonstall, who is represents musicians, he's a union person. And then we have Camila Di Maido, who is a music journalist and organizer of club nights. And finally, we have Liam Blake, who is a musician with a rich portfolio.
Yeah.
As I said, these introductions might be a bit misleading, but if this is the case, you will have the opportunity to correct me and tell more about what you are doing. And basically, the purpose of this panel is to answer the question whether it's possible to live from music in this time. So you are the people who are doing it or try to do it. So we would like to draw on your experience in these different areas in which you are active. And maybe it will be good to start with you, David, because you just had a talk before. And maybe rather than me asking you questions, I wanted to ask the audience whether you have any questions to him. Because you sort of touched upon a very important aspect of music, namely royalties, copyright. Yeah, Les?
Do you see a direction of travel in terms of renegotiations for revenue from streaming that goes to musicians? You know, clearly it's a hot issue at the moment, and I know PRS may not take a view upon it, but would you like to predict a direction of travel?
Yeah, there's other organisations other than us, like Basker, and I think Gamer in Germany, who are our equivalent, are kind of taking a lot more active role in trying to get the digital pie more configured towards the songwriter rather than the label. Just from my experience of going to various conferences and speaking to a lot of experts, I do think in years to come it might change, but I wouldn't hold my breath this year or anything like that. And it's not in everyone's interest for it to change as well, because a lot of the labels are happy with the way it is, and a lot of the labels kind of own a lot of the publishers as well, so they're getting their money from one of the sources.
So we were talking today a lot, actually yesterday also, about the shift from music life from analog to digital. We're talking about the importance of the internet in promoting and reaching the audience. So my first question is actually how much internet plays in your career? If you can draw on your experience, any of you. Yeah?
For me, it's pretty much all of my business. Just to clarify what my business actually does, we've been around about 10 years and we do distribution and promotion and start record labels for independent artists and independent acts all around the world. So we started about 10 years ago, and at the time there was no mechanism for an independent artist to release their own music without a record label. So what we created was a machine that did that, and it was entirely internet based. And around about 2007, obviously when the chart rules changed and it became it was accessible for independent artists to release a record without having a physical copy. That was kind of the start of, in this country, of a lot of digital culture change, when artists were able to release their own record, but also to be able to make a living off the digital marketplace. So stuff that was mentioned earlier about as much as it's made it slightly harder for certain artists to make money because certain revenue streams have closed, the digital marketplace is so wide open, you just need to have a bit more imagination, frankly. There's a lot more avenues for you to make money, and now it's entirely accessible. Previously, you had to have a record deal, and that was the only way you made money, was through that avenue. Now artists can do the entire thing themselves, they just need to be creative, which is kind of, you know, what in theory we are anyway.
Is Digital Music a label service, so to speak?
Kind of, yeah.
So you go to you and you do all the various functions that right. A label used to do before, but it's all in
that's
one
exactly
place, and you take a percentage of income.
We don't take a percentage, we take a service fee.
All right, okay.
So how many artists you have under your wing, so to speak?
At the moment we have about 80,000-85,000.
Right.
And about 17,000 labels. So, I mean, as far as the demographics of them, it's anything from artists just signing up. We also have some artists that are doing quite well at the moment, like Stormzy. We do his stuff, Lady Leisha, a few other upcoming bands. So it's just kind of a hub where artists can have the same services that a record label would do for them, except it's on their own terms.
Do you have a criteria upon which you will allow someone to be sort of use your services, you know, similar to
yeah,
PRS,
sure.
Where you've got to have so many releases before they'll take you on?
No, not really, no. I mean, the only criteria we have is it has to be in good taste, shall we say. I mean, music is subjective, so just because I don't like Swedish death punk doesn't mean someone else doesn't, so, you know, that's not really up to us. What is up to us is, I mean, one of the worst cases we had, there's a guy submitted some artwork, and I'm not going to say what Rizzotti on camera, but he should have been arrested for it, frankly. So we had to ban him. So generally, as long as there's not a legal reason or issue of taste, then pretty much anyone can go out and do what they want. Obviously, there's certain legal implications to do with covers and remixes. Mm-hmm. That when we have four levels of security to deal with that, members of staff. There's one guy in our office called Dale, bless him, and he has to listen to every single track we ever release. And we release about 400 releases a week. So, poor lad, he's half deaf. I feel bad for him. Some of it's good, some of it's not so good. Yeah, but that's just because some music isn't stolen, or it's not remixed, or it's, you know, or it's legal or whatever, or it's not just someone farting on a snare drum. At which point we probably would contact them and say, look, you can do better.
So, how to market yourself, or how to be imaginative about your career? We have here several actual musicians. If any of you can draw on your experience, your ups and downs, maybe, starting with you.
I can definitely, hang on. Can you hear me anyway?
Kind of.
Hello.
Okay.
Hello, and here we are.
Yes, now it's working.
I am classically softly spoken. Now, I can definitely attest to the value and virtue of being savvy when it comes to computers by being personally woefully bad at it. And I'd like to draw on a particular experience I had. A few years ago, I did a master's degree in songwriting, and we had lectures in the evening. And twice a week, directly after the lectures, I would have to literally jump in the car, hop into town to my gigs. I was doing several gigs a week down in Bath there as a jumping musician, which is what I am. And one of my colleagues on the MA who I think up until that point had done maybe two or three gigs in her life. She would mesmerize me by, you know, multitasking throughout the lecture. She would be obviously taking on board what the lecturer was saying, but also managing her online presence. And she did such an amazing job of this that by the time we graduated, I was still a jobbing musician, albeit working a lot, and albeit at that point signed to a small label. But my friend's presence had just gone from strength to strength to strength, and suddenly she was getting booked to do gigs in America, all over the UK, and, you know, having a wealth of opportunities thrown her way. So that was very much an eye-opener to be savvy, in other words, you know, and creative when it comes to your presence online. And not just, I mean, I think it's great, very healthy as a musician to be out there working and gigging, but I think you have to be careful not to immerse yourself in, you know, life on the road.
Right, this is what was said before, that nowadays musicians spend more time in comparison with the past on somehow, you know, marketing yourself, selling yourself, and so in your case, what are the proportions, if you can reveal it, how much time you spend on your music and how much time you spend on selling yourself, so to speak?
Well, I'm embarrassed to say, after saying that I am, well, implying that I learned a valuable lesson, I'm still woefully bad at self-promotion, you know. And I was sitting up here as probably, hopefully, a poor example that you can learn from.
Yes, promote yourself, use the opportunity.
Right, so, you know, okay, my good friend down there, Jake, who's behind the camera, he and I recently did a fab video for a single that I just put out. And that's on YouTube, it's doing its thing. But, you know, I'm really excited to learn from my esteemed colleagues here how you take a great product like a super video and you make it more widely known to people. Because as I say, I'm still forging a career, eking an existence by playing 5-6 times a week to people. And so I'm still woefully, desperately, hopeless at self-promotion. So please, esteemed colleagues, help me.
Colin, yes, maybe you.
I think the DIY ethic really sort of goes a long way to the modern musician. I've been a musician for some 30 odd years, playing in sort of really pub bands from Blackpool in the area, to the point now where we actually use Ditto Music Service. It's not an advert, but to see our original releases being bought, played, and sort of engaged with in Venezuela, Japan, New Mexico, and all over the world, it's quite phenomenal. You know, and we've taken this band we've got, we're playing up and down the country, but also through our online presence that pretty much is left down to me, because with musicians, there's musicians that will and do, and there's some musicians that will just let somebody else do it because it's easier. I'm the type that will and do, I'm afraid. So I get sort of the cap that it's just given to Colin. To the point where, with shadow management now, I've been approached by a number of artists.
Maybe tell me a bit about yourself, in terms of your genre. I can tell that Colin has a ska band.
It's a ska band from Blackpool. We're based up and around sort of the Blackpool pubs and clubs and things for the last 6 years, to the point where we're playing some big events, which has got me to putting on events in Blackpool Winter Gardens, 3,000 capacity, Empress Ballroom. At £30 a ticket, so potential to earn £90,000 in one night. Very, very nice, thank you very much. So the potential's out there to do it, but the marketing is the key thing to it. People are not going to attend, they're not going to come and engage with you unless they you know the market, you know your audience, and you can put the product and package together. And the similar thing, the other bands that have come and approached me are all sort of part of the same genre, similar genres, and they've come to me because what we've done with our band in terms of marketing has really, really worked. Not to say we're any better or any worse than the other bands, but we're just good at what we do. And they're come and say, okay, can you work for us? And that's added another sort of element to the shadow management, where I'm taking on artists now, which I didn't really fully intend to do so. Because bands want to create music. They want to be dealing with the art of it and not so much the business of it. And if somebody else can take that off them and they trust them, and trust and having a good reputation goes a long way, then you're going some way towards it. I mean, I was approached by a cabaret singer, sort of quite off chance, at an event I was attending, and she got Stars in the Rise finalist last year, and she asked me to manage her. She was looking for a manager. I said, well, I'm not really in that game. So we had a sit down and a chat and a coffee. I said, well, what do you do? I do a great Lady Gaga tribute. I said, that's not my audience. I don't know Lady Gaga. I also do Amy Winehouse. Now I'm interested because that fits my demographic, that fits my audience. And she's playing in a couple of weeks in Bucharest, in the Festival of Bucharest, within a couple of months of me taking her on, putting the band together. We're going up and down the country. We're down at a place called the Dublin Castle in Camden the other week. We, as a ska band, to play in the Home of Madness is one thing, but to blow the roof off it is a completely different thing. And then to put an Amy Winehouse tribute in the same boozer that Amy used to drink in, it's calls to Newcastle, really. And a lot of it comes about with the really confidence of people believing in what you do. And the online presence and the DIY aspect is the one thing that people sort of look at what you do and say, you know what, they're doing all right, can you help me?
There's something important that Colin's talking about is apart from reaching out to fans, obviously that is important, and there's the whole social media side of that with Facebook and Twitter and stuff, and that's a whole different topic. I think it's important as well for musicians to realise you do need to connect with people in the music industry as well, because these people are going to help you on your way. It's yes, you need fans, but you also need connections. So coming to things like these, talking to people like us afterwards, or keeping in contact with them. Hopefully people are also attending Liverpool Sound City end of next week. Not sure if any of you are, but you should be, because that's a place where you can meet lots of industry people, because these will help you on your journey. There is one caveat to that. Don't be a prat. They will only help you if you're not a dick to them. So just be yourself, be a nice, normal person, and don't make them feel like you're just after something. Talk to them like you would your mates in the pub. And these people will help you along your journey, because otherwise you're doing this entirely by yourself.
And you need friends.
Yes.
You do.
With the caveat that it is obvious that musicians, artists need to be savvy enough to self-promote, would you say then that there is license in a stargazing romantics like myself, kind of devoting a disproportionate amount of their life to trying to penetrate the human condition through song, which is what we do as songwriters?
I think for me it's having the team around you.
Right.
If that's your thing, then that's what you do, but you need to have a supportive team around you can help you with that. Everybody's good at something, and some people are better at other things than that. So you need to have that support around you to help you do that. Mm-hmm. Then you can focus on what you want to do and have somebody take that promotion aspect or the legal aspect of where it's going to be and help you move forward.
This somehow takes us back to the point of departure, because it seems like the music industry somehow developed. We talk about the record labels declining and no need for that, but actually what we arrive is the conclusion that we need something like that, not necessarily, you know, record labels in the old style, but people who will offer these services. And the question is whether you, some of you, will offer better services than old style, you know, record labels. I don't know, Matthew, maybe you can elaborate on that.
Well, it depends what you define as better. I mean, we enable...
cheaper, more effective?
Yeah, sure. I mean, we enable someone like Stormzy to release his own music, keep all his own money, and keep all his own rights. On the other hand, if you want to plan a world tour, which the likes of Stormzy probably already has done and will be doing, then I would personally recommend to someone like him to look at signing a label deal. The reason for that is, I'm not anti-record label, I mean, they serve a purpose. On the other hand, they have the money, the infrastructure, and the connections. And when you're DIY, you can only really push that so far. At some point, you're going to need a bank, which is a record label. You're going to need a machine, which is a record label. So if artists of a certain level, yes. But when you're starting out, there really, at the moment, isn't really the need, because you don't have to do everything yourself. But you need to get your marketing head on. And going back to what you were saying, as much as you can focus on the art of songwriting, and that is the most important thing, to connect with people and with that. On the other hand, if no one ever hears it, it's all very good for you, but you know, if you're trying to make a living as a musician, what's the point? So there is a, there's a balance there.
Where is this point? You say it's at some point it's better to go to the record.
Well, that's up to the artist. I mean, some artists can keep going. I mean, for you, at what point would you want to sign to a label, like a major deal or something?
Now?
Okay.
Well, I think we get away. The difference between going from, you know, operating 5 nights a week, trying to, you know, living from hand to mouth, and then going to sign a major deal will always be dependent upon whether the person in the major label thinks he can make as much money from an artist or not. It's that simple. Because I used to work for this guy called Tony Wilson, he owned Factory Records, and his philosophy always was, he sees a band, he'll say, if that band can sell 1 million records, then he'll sign them, or thereabouts. That's the big idea. Doesn't necessarily mean that he doesn't want to sign a band that may only sell 20,000 records, because he would do that too, because he lived on an aesthetic. But his principle view to me was, really, when you go and look at a band, because that's what we used to do, we used to run in the city where we put on sort of live events for unsigned bands, and he always tells me, you know, we get the demos in, and if we can go out and see them live, look at them and see what do you think, if you think they can sell 1 million records, then we, you know, you'll sign them to it.
Yes, this is interesting point, and it seems like the situation changed a lot. We had yesterday a paper when somebody mentioned that what we observe in Britain today is the death of stars, pop stars. And he illustrated it by the changes in Platinum Records. So last year only, there were only three artists who sold more than 200,000 records. In comparison, I don't know what year, when there were 35, maybe less,
2004
I remember.
It was.
Huh?
It was 2004.
When there were 35. So we had sort of kind of paradoxical situation when the revenues go up in Britain, but they're actually new pop stars are declining. And the revenues go up largely because the old records sell very well. So mm-hmm. The old music sells. So it seems like this sort of future feeds on the past.
Do you know, I was kind of completely disagree with that. I've read it, but the premise of it, that I don't think that record sales are linked to whether someone's a star or not anymore. If you look at someone like Austin Mahone, who was a big pop star on Instagram a year before last, millions and millions of followers, all those Vine kids. That's what a teenager looks as, is a star. It's someone like Logan Paul. Apparently, to ask any 17-year-old, and he's a big star, no one else really knows who he is. But, you know, that's what people's version of star is. Kids don't buy records anymore, so why would the definition of a star has something to do with record sales. I think it's more to do with, these days for kids, it's more to do with notoriety. It is, it's profile, it's entirely profile. It's how many Vine followers have you got? It's what's your Instagram following? What's your, you know, your interactions, that kind of stuff. I think the record sale thing is completely irrelevant these days for kids.
Yeah, and it's also your PR stunts that people get from time to time, which is then reported in the popular press, which gives them a profile, which then, you know, generates further sales. But you know, the best sales method, as far as I'm aware and I'm still aware, is through live performance. The more live performance you do, you build up your brand, you build it, bring people in, then you know, you increase your notoriety. And then a record company, whether it's major or an independent, might look and say, oh look, his live audience is increasing. Maybe this is about the point where they become interested. Because going back years ago when I used to be involved with certain bands, you know, 1 year we'd be at, say, the Cockpit in Leeds and there'll be probably 100 people. We'd go back, say, 6 months later after we'd released, say, a 12-inch, and there's 200 people in there. It's that sort of increase through your notoriety, and I think that's what brings in more people, because those 200, by word of mouth, probably say, I saw a great band last night. You know, they've got a release coming out in the next couple of months. You know, you should check it out. And so it goes on, which is where, you know, Arctic Monkeys, that's how they built up their brand.
Well, I think the requirement today is really very much going back to the live performance, but having quality video of that live performance that on the social networks, and that's where people sort of engage with it. So you can go to a different part of the country and people still be aware of what you do. So it's not just a local market or a regional market, it can be much further.
I think one of the, for me, I just want to go back a little bit actually, because I think one of the key things for this, we talk about, we're getting into like kind of, our lives are the kind of key driver for it. That's obviously lives massive in terms of income, and particularly in terms of like, particularly labels getting involved and taking what is always a risk for them. The big indicator is there any live revenue? What's the following in live terms? It's not just about stats online, for instance. We were talking earlier about marketing, but whichever area kind of stylistically, genre-wise, an artist is going to sit in, one of the key things is that the artist actually has the product to begin with. So one of the first rules of marketing is to actually have a product that you can sell. Do you see what I mean? So going back to what you were talking about earlier, it's about knowing that what you provide is perhaps something different, what's unique about it, and actually what's the market you're headed for. Because as a songwriter, God knows how many thousand singer-songwriters are out there, probably even just in this area. It's like, what makes you different? Do you see what I mean? And that's, or are you a niche market in itself? And that's the key things we talk about. Perhaps you were comparing before, like major record labels and what, you can't really compare like for like, because it's kind of like the Wild West out there now. There's no rules. And we've had this period of like 30, 40 years where everyone knew exactly what was going on. You knew pretty much who had control, and there'd be new operators here and there, but the system was set up. Now, all the rules are out, and nobody knows where it's going to end up. And what works for one artist who knows exactly what they want to do, and can self-release, can do tours, even Europe-wide, to a certain level, won't work for another artist. So it very much depends on the artist, and them knowing initially what their art market is for me. And from there onwards, anything else could be open to question, according to, if it's, is it a mass market thing? Is it a niche market? You know, what are their particular skills? But that's that, it kind of takes on its own kind of form, if you like.
If I can just chip in as well, I think if the artist is self-aware enough to know what their market is and what their strengths are, I think there's an argument for that artist to be confident enough to sort of hold on to that. And if they do find themselves signing with a small label, as I did, not carry terror too much, because the last deal I had, I think basically they really, their perception of me was a little off, and ultimately the USP that they put across was that I was some kind of, I don't know, love child of Cliff Richard and Julie Andrews. I'm quite sure that was true. Right? And I'll tell you, you know, now I'm not with a label. I mean, the last record I did was financed by an independent sponsor who I came to meet through just playing live. But I sell more units now at gigs than I did when I was in my last label. And I'm still playing 5-6 times a week. A lot of what I do is cover versions, right? But you know, I know my demographic, and I know that my own stuff sits comfortably in amongst the Cat Stevens and Simon and Garfunkel stuff that I do. And I know that I'm going to sell CDs at the end of the gig. So as an artist, I'm seeing more sort of tangible return for my creative endeavours, like songwriting, than I did when I was with a label.
I was just thinking as well about you saying it's like the Wild West. I think now, I mean, previously, say when an artist got a record deal and then they got dropped, that was the end, you know, no one talked about them at the record label. But now I've got, you know, I mean, I've seen it with my friends when they've, you know, been dropped by a major, they've managed to come back with their fan base or, you know, release independently. So I think now there's a lot more possibility to have more chances to break through with sort of online, you know, following or just different ways of distributing your music.
No, so true. People got dropped, they just disappeared off the planet, didn't they?
And, you know, other record labels wouldn't pick them up, but, you know, whereas now there's not that sort of taboo of not picking someone up again, I suppose.
Yeah, because in the old days when people used to get dropped, the band or the artist used to think that's the end. Mm. You know, their career is over, rather than thinking, you know, okay, next, and try to develop further. Because, you know, there have been numerous bands who've been dropped by major labels, then picked up. Even Mariah Carey got dropped. from Sony, then she got picked up through Universal, through Leo Cumming. That's just, you know, a huge example. But there are many others.
That seems like one.
Elbow as well. Elbow is a good example where they got dropped in and got picked up again.
It seems like one important issue, somehow gathering the evidence, yes? Learning how to do it, not doing it in a complete blind way. And you represent various sort of institutions which gather this evidence or have this experience. And I wonder if you can sort of draw on this experience and have some, you know, advice to the aspiring artist, maybe.
If you believe in yourself, then just keep going if you get dropped. It's as simple as that. You've got to believe in yourself.
This is a very general advice. Are there any sort of more specific?
I think, going back to, you need to, first of all, you need to know if you're an artist. I mean, and also, sometimes people need to make the distinction between, are they an artist or are they a musician? Because they can be two very different things sometimes. I think if you're an artist, you need to know who you are, what your target market is. But also then, for you as an artist, say it's a band, it's also about looking about outside of your musical abilities, your songwriting abilities, what other abilities do you have in the band? Because as a band or as an artist, you are a business. Until you engage a third party, such as a manager, a label, etc., an agent, until that point, you're self-contained, you're DIY. So what can you do to get as far as you possibly can as that unit? Because as soon as you kind of involve somebody else, and there's always a right time to do that, the point of it will depend on what are your other skills. So is actually anybody in the band good logistically? Are they good at organisation? Are they good at marketing? Are they good at social media? Are they good at networking? Are they good at artwork in terms of cover art? You know, any different number of different things that you would otherwise have to get somebody else to do. My general advice is to take that as far as you possibly can before you involve somebody else. And then the question you need to ask is, what value are they adding? Do you see what I mean? Because the major record labels are doing that. They're saying, when can we make money out of you? What you need to be saying is, actually, how much more money can they make out? How much more money can they make for us? Because ultimately, in terms of longevity, you need to be making money out of it. Otherwise, you're gonna falter. I think the other thing as well that links into that is not signing agreements at a very early stage. And I'm sure Rudy'd have an opinion on this. But increasingly, you get smaller operators engaging artists in contracts at a very early stage, and they don't know what they're signing, and actually they can be literally signing their careers away. And one of the reasons we don't see necessarily artists moving to other labels is sometimes because there's clauses in those agreements that meant the label would retain the copyrights, and also there'd be like clauses where they couldn't re-record any of that material, for instance, for 5-10 years. And it is, if your best material was all on that album, game over. It's as simple as that.
Also, I would add to that, if you haven't got the skills that you think is needed, then there is no harm in
getting somebody to
upscale your own skills. You know, learn, most things are learned skills. Just like marketing, it's a learned skill. And then once you get to your end, then someone else can come on board, because they would have to add something else to what.
That's where that self-realization comes in. If you're a completely chaotic person as an artist, which is not uncommon, and you know, you might be good at doing your own artwork and kind of, you know, sorting out videos, etc. If it comes to financial stuff or legal or contracts, etc., or booking gigs, sorting out the technical riders, if you're absolutely useless at that, you're going to fall on your backside. So you need to find somebody that can work collaboratively with you to actually fulfill that part. Because if it doesn't happen, you won't find success as an artist.
You represent the artist union, yeah? Can you tell something about what you can offer?
I work for the musicians union, so we represent musicians across the board. And actually, not all of those musicians will be artists. A lot of them work for other people as session musicians, on tour, doing stuff in the studio. But we represent musicians, literally. We've got over 30,000 members in the UK. They range from orchestral musicians at one end of the spectrum through to theatre musicians. We negotiate all the contracts for West End Theatre and touring theatre pretty much. Through to music teachers, but musicians work in pretty much every genre. Most of our members are freelancers, everything from jazz trumpeters, indie drummers, through to drummer bass producers. Anyone that's producing creative content as a musician, basically.
And how the situation changed, let's say, in the last 10 years? Can Matt, and you said it's very difficult to say what this.
Yeah, but you could certainly be very negative. So, I mean, it's certainly in terms of a lot of our members, you see constant challenges year on year in terms of the amount of money that you can make out of music. Let's be honest, it's harder and harder. But it's always been a tough career. But the flip side of that is that if you're really, really good at what you do, there are also people that can make an awful lot of money. And I think the danger is sometimes people can be very, very negative. And I think you made the point earlier that actually it's not always the people that you see in the public eye that can always be the best gauge or best measure of how much money it is to make. There's lots of people that earn good livings that are completely under the radar because they found what their niche market is, they know what their audience is, and they know how to cater to them. Colin gave him the example of his own band there, and it's like, you wouldn't necessarily be widely aware of that band in the south of England, for instance. Certain people may be in certain places. If you're into ska, obviously, that would be different. But they know what their market is, and they know what the audience is, and they know how to put bums on seats and to grow that. And that's important. And just because something isn't like in the age, you know, 15 to 25 bracket and, you know, in mass media across the board, that doesn't necessarily mean it's not successful.
Yeah. Just to add to that, in addition to being a music lawyer, I'm also a pop music publisher, and I've run record labels as well. And we had one, a writer who, you know, we thought he was a good writer. He was a drummer, and he decided that he wanted to do become a songwriter. And it just so happens that the music he wrote lends itself to being synchronization on TV shows and films. And just so happens that with car shows, they always seem to be asking for his music. And within the space of a year, we lent him about $3,000, and he used that to buy equipment to record at home. And within a year, he was earning like $100,000 a year. So, you know, success is relative. For someone who lived up in, you know, Barrow and Furness, and he's earning $100,000 a year, he was doing well, as far as I'm concerned. he was doing well in comparison to other. So, but, you know, he was a writer that we recognised, and then it just so happens that it was, you know, more amenable to being a synchronisation. He didn't have a hit record, but he's on $100,000 a year from his writing, and he's still doing well now, even though we've parted company.
It kind of goes back to what I was saying in my talk about when I joined POS 10 years ago. I was surprised by all these. I thought I knew a lot about music, and then I was looking at all these members I'd never heard of earning a serious amount of money, yeah. And they were all media writers. They wrote music for TV, they wrote jingles and things like that, and music for sync. So yeah, you don't just have to be a pop star, you don't have to be a tour musician, you can earn a lot of money through kind of non-conventional routes as well.
If you look at the amount of sort of streaming services you've got, catch-up TV, and the number of digital channels you've got now, and every time it's played, then you get a fee from it. I mean, the options are endless in terms of doing that as a different stream, but again, it's not sort of being successful in terms of in the public profile. You just get on with it and do your own job. So it's all about defining your own success. What do you want out of it?
I mean, this somehow, again, comes back to what was discussed yesterday and today to some extent, that we have more of music than ever in the past, but somehow this music plays different functions than it used to be. And this also reflects different sort of careers and streams of revenue. In the past, it was sort of assumed that the people who write songs and play songs will be the most successful. Nowadays, there are other issues like the other ways to earn money, like jingles and so on. So we will confirm that this is the case, and this will be a good career for somebody. Just, you know, don't be a stargazing artist, but rather sort of focus on this type of work.
Yeah, I've got clients who just write solely music for television, just for synchronization. Because when I first met him and he came to me and I asked him to list the songs that he's written, and it's like about 6 pages of music. I've never heard of this, but he had his own studio, and he's making a very decent living out of it. You know, you don't have to focus on being the pop star. There's other routes to earning an income from the music industry, and you also have to look at the fact that someone once said that with digital music, it should be seen as the equivalent of having a record store on the corner of every street, because that's where you should be distributing music through, you know, people like Ditto or other platforms.
Camila, you know quite a lot of young musicians. Do their careers somehow reflect this shift from music to music as an addition to something else?
Yeah, I think my sort of most successful friends also, for example, make video or they have different strings to their bow. They're not just musicians. And I think increasingly to get recognised by the press, it's not enough just to be a musician. It's not enough to be an MC. You know, if you can do more things, you're kind of more likely to get attention, I think. And I think it kind of transpires to what I do as well. I mean, I started my journalism career because I was doing a club night, and the publication called Vice contacted us to write a profile about Manchester clubbing. And I'd never done any journalism before, and I didn't have a blog, and I didn't really know much about music, but I was just doing a club night for fun, and then that's how it started for me. So, and I have a lot of friends who are trying to be journalists or are journalists, and they've been, you know, they've done degrees in journalism, or they've got blogs that they've had for years, and that's not got them to that point, whereas I kind of managed to fast forward that way. So I think having, you know, creative inroads into what you want to do is more likely to get you noticed.
Thank you very much. We talked quite a lot among each other. I wonder if there are any questions from the audience at this point. Yeah?
No? Can you, in the process of getting stuff out there, one thing that seems to have been around but then faded is crowdfunding. Have you got any comments on whether crowdfunding is still a powerful tool, or whether the artist suddenly realises that they have to be musician marketer, they have to perform all these roles in order to get that material out there? Then do you think crowdfunding is something that's still got a future, or something that's going to fade away?
I think crowdfunding probably has a future, just how long for, based on the fact that, you know, as you said, the artists have to be, you know, many things. And if he can find someone or some people to back him or her or the band, then great. It's just what that band has to offer other than the music that they will produce from the finances that they receive. Because, you know, there have been many people out there who've tried crowdfunding and have been unsuccessful. They didn't receive the amount of money that they required. And there are others who've, you know, been oversubscribed. So, you know, it just depends on, it's like music anyway, when you put it out, you know, it depends on who your music connects with, and whether it connects with an audience and the number of people that music would connect. And, you know, crowdfunding is just a variation thereof.
If I could just contribute in very general terms, whilst in a funk of depression, having been rejected by one of these crowdfunding programs for having an insufficient reach, you know, dearly, we think you're great, however, you know, we need more than your mum and dad to like what you do. Very, very shortly after that time, I was approached by an independent sponsor whose motivation I still have yet to really work out, but he basically, I just think it's altruism, honestly. He just funded my last record and wants to fund future projects, wants to put me in America to play gigs. And, you know, seemingly, just for the love of helping somebody who loves what they do and can connect with people by doing what they do. So in very general terms, I think, as an idea, there's a lot of merit in the idea, well, in people funding artists. I think that will always continue to be the case. If you are sincere about what you do, and your desire is ultimately to connect with other people, you ought to actually have that opportunity eventually, I think logic dictates.
See, crowdfunding is basically coming full circle, because if you think back or know historically, artists, i.e. fine artists, were always funded by a sponsor. You know, Cezanne and all those great, you know, painters were always funded by a sponsor. So in the modern day, crowdfunding is probably the equivalent thereof. So, you know, because I've known, you know, artists who've picked up a sponsor who's quite willing to pump money into them, you know, because they'd have a job and say, you know, I think you should give up your job, I'll pay you a wage, so that you can concentrate on your music, and you know.
We were talking yesterday as well about brand sponsoring musicians more. Do you think that's a positive change, or?
Well, it depends on what they want. Brand sponsors is a different entity altogether, because with brand sponsors, of course, the purpose of them sponsoring an artist, a band, or anything in the music is to get the
you know, public to see their brand, to purchase their products as well. So, you know, it depends on what they want, is whether you give, you're giving up something for, you know, for that money. You know, it's whether a story which I can't say I know, but I've been told, is that, you know, Coldplay were offered, I think, in the early stages of their career, something like $200,000 just to do a synchronization. They turned it down because it wasn't in their politics of how they see things happen. So, you know, but for another artist, that'd be, you know, a major deal for them, you know, more than selling records. So,
do you have views on branding and crowdfunding, as there are sort of two types of sponsoring, from below and from above,
yeah. I think there's a third type as well, which is a company called Pledge Music, who sometimes get banded in with the crowdfunding thing, although really they're actually not. And that it was referenced in the lecture before this. I can't remember the gentleman's name, sorry. But he said, toward the end of it, he said on about the future of music, and he said it could be to do with shared experiences. Pledge Music already kind of do that. Their business model is they'll have an experience where the band, for a fee, the band will play at your party, or there'll be some like a Skype singing lesson or something. It's multi-layered, so that kind of thing is already existing. So that is something interesting for artists as well. With the crowdfunding, I think it's a bit of an anomaly, because in not many other industries do you actually get stuff like that. I mean, if I went to do an Cornish
film,
I wouldn't get funding for it.
Does it have a future?
That depends on how the artists market themselves to actually get people to fund them in the first place. Artists don't deserve a handout just because they've written a song. They deserve a handout because they connect with people, and people want to invest in them. In the same way as if I wanted to invest in a coffee shop, I'd want to know more about them, not just that I like their coffee. If fans are going to invest in artists, then the artist needs to make some kind of effort to actually connect with people.
I think like there's two different things potentially with the connectivity, and also we talked about the word investment as well in terms of like it being a business relationship. We're really talking about particular branding. It's like they're buying into some particular rights or some particular exposure or particular link up that could be for a period of time, could be to do with a certain release. And that's where artists particularly need to be careful of making sure that what they're getting back is going to match in terms of their future development, and also that the actual money that you're getting is worth what they're giving away. And that's where you kind of need proper legal advice. But going back to the crowdfunding as a concept, I mean, for me, the clue's always been in the name. Ultimately, in the early days of crowdfunding, it worked spectacularly well for a lot of artists that have been dropped from labels who had all the marketing over, you know, decades previously, from major labels, still had a massive following, kind of latent following, if you like, that would still buy into what they were doing. And that worked very, very effectively. I think where you're an up-and-coming artist, the hard thing is if you haven't got a crowd, so to speak, you have to be doing something that's very, very different, or that grabs people's attention or their emotions, or something that's going to make them kind of want to buy into what you're doing and say, yeah, I want to be a part of this. And it could be, I think there's the people that do it successfully, certainly in my experience, are those that are very innovative. It's not, you know, different pieces of artwork, you know, different, you know, house gigs, all those kind of different experiences, writing a song for a member of their family. I mean, the list goes on. I have seen, though, I think from some of the work we do, there's a balance to be had by the artist of you commit to all these things, and you have come across some members of ours that have had a couple of $100,000 out of it. But the problem is you've also then got to fulfill all of those tasks afterwards. And that can actually be quite an undertaking, and stuff that you need to think about, you know, going to some house in a kind of weird part of the country that you've never come across on your own, and all those kind of things. There's lots of things to consider, actually, not just the money. It's like, how are you actually going to carry these things out? But what's positive about it, particularly with an organisation like Pledge, is that link to an audience. And there's plenty of artists that may only have a small crowd, you know, they may only have like, you know, a couple of thousand followers or whatever online, but actually if those are really devoted fans that will buy into what they're doing, they can actually make quite a decent living out of it.
1,000 true fans?
Yeah, exactly. Mm. 1,000 true fans.
Okay. So we can somehow tackle two issues together, and maybe it will be worth to somehow divide them, although they are connected. One is how to start a career as a musician, what factors take into account, and the second, how to make this career sustainable. So if you if you would give advice to people who want to do it, and also to ask the educators, because some of us want to actually help people to achieve these goals, what would be your advice on any of these questions? Maybe the question to you is, was there somebody who helped you in the first place? Or was it all your decision, your learning process to achieve some success?
Well, I was very fortunate to have a very supportive family around me. I mean, when I first came to this university, it was to study law, actually. And I did a year, mm-hmm. and I realised that perhaps it wasn't the world for me, and decided to switch to contemporary performing arts and music. And I believe it was the first year, actually, that programme ran. But yeah, so I suppose having a very supportive family in the first instance, but truly, it was just the thing that has propelled me in the first instance and has continued to sustain me is the desire to make music. And again, that's not very glam, but that's not just limited to, you know, writing my own music and making records. You know, I just love making music. I love making it with other people. I love being on a stage, singing the boxer to a bunch of people while they're having their dinner. I just enjoy it. And again, as romantic and as general as that may sound, I think one's heart has to be in it, really. And if you want to connect with people, then offer them your heart.
Yeah, I hate to do a sales pitch, but the amount of musicians I speak to who haven't joined PRS for Music and they've missed out on hundreds of thousands of pounds, it's a no-brainer to me. If you're thinking of a career in music, a songwriter, join PRS for Music, it's £50, and then it's just a one-off initial investment, and then every time your music's used, you don't need to do anything. Basically, the money will come in every time you use it on the radio or TV, you report to gigs to us. It might not be a lot of money when you're starting off, but if you get more successful playing lots of gigs, it can be hundreds of thousands of pounds. One of my best mates is a touring musician. Every time he's on the phone to me, he's like, things are going amazing, I'm playing all these shows. He comes to Manchester, I go see him, it's literally me, my wife, and about two other people. And I'm like, it's not going that great, is it? He gets his beer money. Because I work for PRS, I make sure he logs his gigs with us, and means that he plays all around Europe all the time. He gets a couple of grand a year just from PRS that helps him with his costs and things like that. So it might not be your primary source of income, but it can help a lot.
I think for me is to go forward, when you're dealing, if you're going out there to begin with, is to do it positively. When you're engaging with other people, either audience or sort of the sound engineer or the promoter, you don't know who you're going to come across next. And so people work on a network of contacts, and being positive and having a positive outlook goes a long way. And just trying to be yourself and be true to yourself and treat people with respect, I think you've just got to sort of just go for it, really. And any support you can have, whether it be friends or family or band members, and utilise the skills that you've got collectively to move yourself forward. It is quite very much a DIY ethic, but you've still got to sort of use the skills that you've got, because a lot of skills are required.
If I think back before I started this company, between like 95 and 2005, I played in a band, played drums, I played for 10 years. And if I think of why we failed as musicians, which kind of worked out all right, because it's why we succeeded as businessmen somehow, but why we failed was we had a disproportionate focus on getting signed by a major. That was our only focus, and it was wrong. Back then, admittedly, late 90s, turn of the century, it was pretty much impossible, pretty much, for an artist to actually succeed by themselves doing the independent DIY stuff. Obviously, we can do that today. But that was our entire focus, and that was wrong. We didn't spend much time doing live stuff. I mean, we got signed by a management company, who at the time were looking after So Solid Crew and Blazing Squad. Anybody heard of them? Yeah, fine, thank you. Anyway, so we got there, and we thought it was a big deal, and our first ever show was in the Sony building in London, and it was in their private studio down in the basement somewhere, and there was all the A&R guys had turned up, and a few other majors had turned up, and this was a really big deal. And our manager sent us down to London on his bus, and he said, right, all you got to do, lads, you've got to turn up, plug in, and they'll ship you upstairs and give a record contract. And that is exactly what we wanted to hear, obviously. Problem about imagine what happened next. So our manager came up to us and he said, right guys, you know, I saw you in the studio about 6 months ago, you know, you were just a bit rough around the edges, but I presume you've been touring ever since. We're like, oh no, we don't need to do that. We didn't play one gig with this new band. And he said, right, okay, so the songs that the labels like, they've all got the CD, they've all heard the music, you know, have you been practicing those in the studio? And we said, oh no, we've taken a bit of a divert now. We actually do ragga these days. What's the definition of ragga? Anybody? Yeah. Anyone know ragga is?
I'll start very quickly.
Yes, we were four white boys doing ragga. Don't know what the hell's going on there. So, and as we had no live experience, we were focused on was we've got a record, got to get a record contract. We kind of ignored basic things like songwriting and performance and musicianship. And by the end of the gig, everybody had walked out, including our manager. And there was just the sound man sitting there with his head in his hands going, boys, what have you done? And that was the end of my music career. So if there's anything you can learn from that, it's get your focus right and make sure it is like a business. So make sure you've got all your departments right. I mean, we weren't doing any marketing. We didn't have a live product. We were quite good in recordings. And that was pretty much about it. We didn't dress properly. There was no image. It was a bit of a farce. So learn from my mistakes. That's the advice I can give you.
How to have a sustainable music career. As from a musician's point of view, it's just, I think, about keep going, because I've got people I'm still working with some 18 years on, simply because they've kept going. You know, they've put out an album, they may have sold well, but it takes them a while to get to the next stage where they have sufficient funding, then they put out something else. And while they're still doing that, they're still playing live as well. And they've also branched off into other things. So one or two of them gone into being DJs, and then they go back to playing live. Because most musicians, bands, artists, their career is like up and down. Sometimes you're popular, then you have a dip, then you become popular again. And if you just keep going, then, you know, you're just riding each wave as it comes along. You know, that's why bands reform. You know, you have an argument, you split up, you don't want to work with them, have a lull, you might get back together again. Could be because a promoter put down some, you know, lots of money on the table and say, you know, reform and you can have X. That's also a driver as well. But if you still feel the need, and as I find some musicians still feel the need to put music out there, irrespective of whether, you know, they're going to sell 5 or 5,000, they just keep going.
If you look at the bands like the 1975, I mean, they were around for many, many years before that, touring, gig, and doing as much as they could. Bands like, I think, Pulp were playing for 10 years before they got signed by anybody.
Yeah,
you're right, actually, just keep going. Just and when the time is right, it'll happen.
But the question is, who can keep going? I mean, you mentioned that you had a very supportive career, and this somehow brings to my mind what Owen Harley wrote in one of his books, actually the book on pulp, about the changing demographics of artists or singers in Britain, namely how it became very middle class or upper class profession. Because it's easy to say, you know, keep going, but you still have to somehow live on something. So it's obvious that if you have what you describe as investment, which can come from your family, you can keep going much longer than if you don't have it. So I again wonder if this is something which you observe in your work, the sort of class.
It's kind of a mirror of life, isn't it? Huh? Yeah, really. I mean, if you look at the kind of our country as it exists now, I mean, I think. There's clear divides opening up in terms of like people's ability, not just in music, but there's a big discussion in the last few weeks about actors, for instance, the number of actors from different backgrounds, and that kind of that's mirrored really across society in lots of different professions. The long and short of it, it's a lot harder to get up the ladder
And if you come from a rich family or you have a rich partner, you're better placed to do that because you can stay the course longer. Because some of it is about, let's make no bones about it. First of all, you've got to be really bloody good. If you want to be a good, successful musician, you've got to be really good at what you do. You've got to have good songs, whether it's written by you or somebody in your entourage or in your band. You must have good material. If you don't have those, it's very hard to have success anyway. But staying the course so that those opportunities come up is the key, probably the most difficult thing for most musicians and artists to do. And it's how do you do that? Now, if you're not from a privileged background, you can kind of go, woe is me, this should have happened. Or you could do like lots of people do, and it comes back to the drive. It's like, are you in this because you want to be famous or you want money? Or are you in this because you love making music, you love writing songs, you love performing? And actually, I think Tony Wilson famously talked about all the bands he signed, certainly the most successful ones, it was like they couldn't do anything else. That was the whole kind of thing. It was like, what would these people do? And I think underneath it, actually, for a lot of musicians, there has to be that drive, because there are going to be very hard times and you have to be able to deal with that. Now, what can you do practically if you're kind of waiting for 4 or 5 years for an opportunity to come, that hopefully will come? It's being pragmatic and looking at what you can do that can dovetail into it. I mean, lots of people, I'm sure, an institutionalized artist will talk about portfolio careers, different activities that can feed into what you do as a musician. Those may be non-musical activities, like you mentioned, on making videos or journalism or any other number of different things. Or it might be other musical activities. So a lot of our members would do, they might have an artistic project that they're trying to pursue, but they might also do writing for TV on the side as and when the advert pitch is coming, and they go for them when they've got a couple of free days, because that works in quite nicely. They may do covers bands or corporate music that they're able to kind of divvy up between other and depth out to other musicians. If a tour comes up or for an important gig for their artistic project comes up, they can go, I'll prioritise that and I'll depth this out to somebody else. But they have got other incoming coming in that's got a flexible nature to it. And that's a key thing for lots of successful musicians, is divvying up these different things. I just wanted to bring up one little thing as well, is that even when you're an artist and you have like everything comes from your artist pot, what we used to have is like the recordings pretty much funded everything. And that doesn't happen every now and anymore, as we now know. We're looking at live income, merchandising, etc., synchronisation. It's coming from lots of different sources. One of the key things people miss actually with streaming is that you used to have like a record releases, and in the first 6 to 12 months, that was when pretty much all of the money came in, unless you were a massively successful artist and you were selling back catalogue. What we've now got with streaming is actually, unless you're a kind of flash in the pan artist, you'll have an initial kind of around the time of release boost in terms of like streams. But actually that music could be streaming the same number of streams pretty much once it levels out 15, 20, 25 years later. Because actually, if there's still an interest in that music, people no longer own it, but they're going to still play it, albeit not necessarily quite as often. But where you had the one-off hit with the sale in terms of an LP on vinyl, on CD, on cassette, you've now got something that just slowly earns money over a long period of time. So if artists can successfully weave in other streams, in the long term, that could be a quite positive thing.
This would suggest don't do the record, do something different, do it bit by bit, yes? This will be the difference, yes? I would say that doing the record is no longer the sort of golden...
I think it's still a key part of it. It represents your a body of work is still important for an artist, but whether they think about that strategically and release it as singles, for instance, rather than an album is one question. But the point I'm making is that music, if it's successful to a degree, will keep earning money for a significant period of time. It won't just disappear and then you're dropped 2 years later because that album was successful and the one after bombed and there's no more money.
I agree, because I recently had a client in the last 6 months who came in, and he was a bit concerned because his PRS income had just suddenly bumped up just out of nowhere, because he previously he was getting something like 10 quid every 6 months, 10 quid or 10, 20 quid. Then suddenly, he's getting like 30 grand, and he sort of said, he came into me and said, Rudy, I don't know. Because he wasn't sure whether his songs would be properly credited. That's what he's concerned with. He says, why suddenly have I got, 30 grand when, the last 10 years I've only been getting 2, 3 quid, 20 quid, a little bit by bit. And it just so happens that streaming came online, and it accumulated, and then suddenly PRS started paying it through. So he's not involved in music anymore. He's working for the BBC Sport. So yeah, it's just what you say about music. You know, having put your music out there, streaming can sort of start bringing, you know, income at a later stage. You know, even though sometimes I don't agree with the amount of money that artists are getting from the streaming.
Now, just going on the flip side of kind of what Matt was saying, I speak to a lot of members who kind of complain about streaming and downloads, because in the past, when you press the CD and say there's 100,000 sales, every track on the album got the same amount of money. To bet, it didn't matter whether it was a hit song or it was just some filler track. Now, in a world of downloads and streamings, people just listen or just buy the good songs. They don't frequently buy the whole album.
Yeah. So,
what I mentioned, not a record, but song matters now more than the whole record.
So, yeah. Say you're just a songwriter, you can just write a song. It's a crap song, but in the past, you could have rode on the coattails of all the good songs that sold that album. Now, no one's streaming or no one's downloading your music.
Yeah, so less
they're missing
what you call album tracks.
Yeah.
Let's be kind. The album tracks. There's album tracks and there's singles and, you know, and so on. Yeah. But yeah, you know, I do, because, you know, that cherry picking was going on even when there was vinyl. It's just that you never played them as often. You know, you played the songs on those vinyl albums that were either singles or songs that you liked specifically. But the album tracks that, you know, the band probably just wrote just to fill out the album. You just didn't play them, and you know, of course, you had to take them along with everything else. Because now, you know, you have the, because of digital, you have the facility to cherry pick. I mean, I do it myself when I go on iTunes.
And I'm sure somebody's done some research, but you could quite possibly argue that bigger than actually all the digital changes is the fact that now people can just buy the tracks that they want, rather than paying for 10, 12, 13 every time. You know,
but on that, isn't the onus on the artist to make better songs, though?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, before that, they could just get away with writing an album track, but now no one's going to buy it, they're not going to get any money off it, so the artists need to write some better songs.
Yeah, well. You know, that's probably why Thriller was in the charts for so long, because it had so many singles off it.
But by being positive about streaming, I'm not for one moment suggesting that the payments from streaming are adequate, because that's a whole other question. I'm just making the point that those payments do exist, you know, on a much longer term basis. You know, certainly in terms of certain video companies and the way the ad revenue is not distributed is like a big, big issue. But one of the things we're campaigning for as well is in terms of the way the royalty payments are split up. There's currently no PPL payment, for instance, on a stream. It's how you define a stream, as opposed to with a broadcast, for instance. Dan mentioned PPL in terms of his presentation. So session musicians, for instance, that played on the track would receive PPL payments from radio broadcasts. With a stream, which is arguably a bit of a hybrid, it's kind of something in its own right, which is why PRS MCPS is split 50-50. That's the thinking behind that. But there's currently no PPL payment for stream.
I'm going backwards somewhat, but whilst we're on the subject of money, I just want to clarify that the kind of support I was referring to earlier was emotional, spiritual, and not fiscal. I don't come from a wealthy family, but my point was this, that there are those, as a working, jobbing musician, songwriter, producer, as I have been, organiser of events. I also set up, shortly after graduating from here, a sort of community non-profit label to help develop artists I met at an acoustic night that I ran in town. In and amongst these events, the hours spent cold calling venues to try and get gigs, to then finally get the gig, to have your teeth chipped out because there's a fight's broken out, right? It's not very glam sometimes, and so to be able to draw on the support of your family when you will inevitably question your decision to be an artist, I think is vital in terms of sustainability. So sorry to backtrack a little bit, but I just wanted to
clarify that.
Should we have more questions from here?
Rudy, you mentioned that about your client earning £30,000 from streaming. Mm-hmm. I assume you mean YouTube ad revenue.
Yeah, there's all probably.
Because that wouldn't be Spotify, would it?
No, definitely. Correction. Yes, it was YouTube.
Is it fair to say that a million streams on Spotify would earn you about a tenner.
I would. I'm inclined to agree with you, but they're in that ballpark because I've read various articles where, you know, very famous sort of A-list artists were complaining about the amount of revenue they've received from Spotify.
That's one of my bugbears when I hear artists complaining, because it's, as I kind of said in my presentation, it's split between, like, if you're self-leasing, you get a share of it through Ditto or your record label, and then you get a share of it through PRS and MCPS. And unfortunately, we have to sign what's called non-disclosure agreements with the likes of Spotify and YouTube, so I can't actually say how much it is, but the actual subscription model of £10 a month does pay quite well compared to sort of freemium service, and it is a lot better than a million plays for, did you say a tenner? It is a lot better than that.
Yeah, I read articles like that, and I actually don't know where they get their figures from. I mean, as a distributor myself, I see the raw sales data of 80,000 artists across the world, and I mean, in the US, you do get very, very small amounts, but then again, there's not much marketing money in there. In Sweden, you get more, in the UK, you get more, and so forth. But what I will say is that I started doing guest lectures about four or five years ago, maybe. And at that time, I used to do a sales graphic with a pie chart of where all my artist money came from, and 80% of it was iTunes, and about 7% was Spotify. I did the same lecture about 3 months ago, and it was 30% Spotify, which I think is probably indicative of a lot of the independent market. So as much as artists might moan about how much money they're not getting from Spotify, it's actually a third of their income. Just saying.
Yeah, there were a couple of comments that I found particularly interesting. The phrase, 1,000 true fans, has resonated. I wonder whether, in many TV programs such as The X Factor, Britain's Got Talent, a certain image of mainstream music is presented, and I suppose in many people's minds that is the music industry. But it's been suggested that in the internet age, more diversity, more opportunities for extreme or strange or quirky forms of music. I think Chris Anderson wrote The Long Tail probably over 10 years ago now, and he predicted that the internet age would allow people to move away from the mainstream and would encourage much more diversity. I'm wondering whether the changes that you've seen, whether you think it makes it easier for those unusual, difficult, non-mainstream, specialist areas of music to have sustainability.
You're talking about jazz.
jazz is state sponsored music these days. You know, jazz is supported by Arts Council funding, and it's part of our cultural heritage. But I suppose, you know, I don't know, Japanese noise music or perhaps strange extreme forms of metal that my colleague Niall will be able to tell you more about. Is it easier or more difficult for sustainability for those kind of more diverse and niche forms of music?
I don't know about sustainability, but it is easier to get access to these music, you know, diverse music. However, because it is diverse, it takes more time to find it because there's that much of it. Mm-hmm. As you're speaking there, I was thinking back to when I first opened my office in 1996. I used to get the Music Week, and at the back of the Music Week, you used to see the number of singles and albums being released in any particular week. And you know, it run into thousands. I mean, I wouldn't, you know, get half the chance to listen to any of those songs. You know, because you'll get certain ones, you know, they're going to come up, you know, sort of on Radio 1, on their, you know, A-list, B-list, and so on and so forth. But this diversity, you wouldn't know. Whereas now, when a single is released by, you know, Ashimoto somewhere in Japanese noise music, if you're interested in that genre of music, you basically put yourself on an alert
on the various platforms, and you'll know when a new, you know, release is being made. So, you know, there's access to it. It's easier access because of the digital age. But in the old days, it would be way much difficult to get to that sort of music.
I think as a working musician in a niche music of ska music, in Jamaican music, I think it's easy for us to connect with the audience because of the community. For me, certainly within niche music, there are communities out there that use the social media channels that are quite closed in some ways, but they all talk together as well in other ways. And a lot of my music is based on heritage acts as well. So to connect with those heritage acts, and that brings in the pull and draws people together, we can travel all over the country and quite happily sort of fill out venues, which is would have been unheard of 10 years ago, certainly, because we wouldn't have been able to connect in the same way we can these days.
Mm. Which somehow brings me to my other question, namely the relation or place in contemporary music. You know, in the past, the saying was that you have to go to London, yes, to make a career. Does it still matter where you make your music and when you
I think live? To make a career, you have to go to Twitter or Instagram. And that enables you to go down to London and play a gig at a nice club and get more fans and then go to Sheffield the next night. Stuff like that doesn't really matter anymore, to be honest.
And it depends what if your aim is to get signed, so to speak, then perhaps that would be. But if you're, it's a niche market and it turns out there's a massive market for it in the northeast of England, well, you're not, there's no point going to London, go where the audience is. I agree with both the comments, actually. I think it's really opened it up for people to control their own artistic output and connect with fans. That's brilliant. The only concern, I think, in the long term, the flip side of that, is a lot of people for years were complaining about, you know, the number of major record labels, and we eventually got down to four and then to three, and like how much control they exerted on the industry. We've now, you know, in terms of the way things tend to work in terms of big multinational companies, who knows where we'll end up in 3-4 years? Will we still be talking about Deezer, Tidal, Spotify, Apple Music, or will they just be one? And I think the danger is you've gone from perhaps these, you know, a few record companies that can control everything. So we could have a situation where we've got one or two organisations that effectively control the output and the terms and conditions.
Major labels haven't controlled the music industry for very, very long. The people who control it is Spotify and Apple. Because what labels should have done 10 years ago was invent iTunes, and they didn't. That Apple did, and now they control the music industry, so that if a major label single goes off sale for some reason, they will lose thousands an hour on it, and they have absolutely no control over it. None of these labels stepped in and invented iTunes or invented Spotify. Someone else beat them to it. And now you have tech companies that, to an extent, control the music industry in the way we listen to it.
I think that's the danger, particularly when we talk about stuff like non-disclosure agreements, where much as artists have got a degree of independence, when it gets to a certain level, they have absolutely no control or say in actually, you know, how much their recompense for their music and their output. Mm-hmm. That's the danger, and we're very close to that, actually.
There was some questions. Yes, you have a question.
Yeah, so leading on from that, it's I was kind of along the same chain of thought, and like, what's people's thoughts on sort of aggregation of viewing sort of music in terms of like how streaming has affected people's you know, consumption of music, and you know, as the first speaker was saying, how people get the music in terms of, like, you know, we've seen recently, like, Facebook and Google have, you know, had influences on elections and things like that. What's the sort of view in terms of trying to pull people, sort of, I don't know whether it's pulling people away from sort of niche markets towards the mainstream, or away from mainstream towards the niche markets?
Pop Idol take us away from niche markets, you know, all that sort of TV, reality, voice and so on and so forth, which I have no time for, but, you know, that's another, you know, for someone else. You know, that skewed the market for me, and I saw that, you know, when it first started coming out, because, you know, these mothers would be bringing their daughters or sons into my office and say, I'll pay you to listen to my son and tell me if you think I can get him on Pop Idol. And I said, no, don't, just keep them quiet, because I don't want to listen to them, because you see the pattern. And unfortunately, that took away from, you know, what I call the real musicians out there who are, you know, are going to gig and sort of playing the flipping flea pits and the bogs and so on, just to, you know, be what they want to be, that is musicians, and expressing themselves, have a voice, whether it's, you know, social commentary or a love story that they want to communicate with others. And I think in that respect, the consumption of music is determined by the amount of people who are getting watching TV on a, I don't know if it's on Saturday or Sunday night or whatever night, and then they're rushing to Spotify or Apple to sort of consume that sort of music, even though it's only for a short period of time, because the people who purchase that music has only got a very short sort of attention span, because they don't stick with those artists, which is why they get, you know, they get dropped. You know, they'll have one hit, then they're off, and they're on to the, and, you know, Simon Cowell's on to the next artist. So, you know, the consumption there is to a certain extent determined by what's on TV, but it also gives us an opportunity, if you're not into that, to go and look for other things as well.
Yeah, and Matt from Ditto can probably answer this better than me, but in terms of consumption, a lot of people tell me that kind of the playlisters on Spotify and Apple Music are now the tastemakers. They're the most important people to, if you get on a big playlist, that's going to break your record, as opposed to getting an old radio plugger, getting a track on radio like the old days.
It's a question of curators. This was something which was discussed.
So I guess yesterday. The question is that does the curation on Spotify playlist actually lead to success? I would say no. I think it's a part, I think it's a small part of an entire cake of what else are you doing with your life. But if I look at some of our artists who've got a decent level on a Spotify playlist, then that's pretty much all they get. I mean, someone like Izzy Bazoo, anybody know that name?
Yeah.
So she was on front page of iTunes a couple of years ago, and there was, she thinks she was single track of the week or something. And she clocked thousands upon thousands of downloads, free downloads, and absolutely nothing happened for about another year when it happened naturally. And there was another guy called Vijay Kishore, who's from Birmingham, and he got a big feature on iTunes and free downloads, and he clocked like 250,000 free downloads in a week or something stupid. And absolutely nothing happened, and his label dropped him 2 weeks later. So as much as it's, you know, I mean, I listen to Spotify playlists, and it's a good way of getting music in front of people. It's a part of the puzzle, but not the solution to it. But nevertheless, it is starting to dictate what we do. I think that maybe, like, I think Zane Lowe moved across to Apple Music to curation or something like that. Whether that was a good business move for Apple's point of view, because of how much money they probably paid him, I don't know. What good does it actually do for the music industry?
I still think that, you know, to find certain music is going out to see bands, because there's a band I discovered, you know, last year called Future Islands, and it's only because I was watching Glastonbury on TV and they came on, that's a good tune. So I went and went on, you know, do some research on it, and their album was great, so I bought it.
The other thing about by Spotify, by listeners, if you look at like the younger market, it's such a throwaway culture. They may listen to a song on a Spotify playlist or Apple playlist once, but they probably won't listen to it again. And they'll completely forget who that band is, or they may not even look at their device to find out what the name of the song is. So it's all part of a massive, massive machine, a massive puzzle that, you know, goes like with Stormzy. He's on quite a few playlists on Spotify these days. He's also touring the world and been in the top 40 quite a few times. So it's just part of a huge thing that artists need to be.
Wrap up. So my sort of last question is, imagine the industry in 10 years. What do you think will be its most important characteristic from your perspective, from the perspective of your career?
I think it's going to be content, simple as. if you got content.
Just one sentence, I think, maybe.
People. I think it still comes down to people. We were talking about a resurgence of the folk tradition in the sense that people are out there making music in front of people. It doesn't matter how many people, but there seems to be that seems to be a viable way of reaching and connecting with people. So I think it comes down to people.
Camila, you were both in journalism and
yeah, I think a resurgence of local music scenes. Yeah, we were saying people sort of going out to their local venues and just rediscovering local music.
I think we've reached a point where recording's so easy to do, so easy to put music out there that it's kind of everywhere. And that's brilliant, as we've discussed in many respects, that the artists can get material out when it's ungoverned by other organisations, companies, etc. Brilliant. But we've had a long-term kind of phrase in the MU, a slogan, if you like, keep music live. It's kind of one of the key things we're about, is about making sure musicians can play live. And I think actually, we're starting to see this, actually, it will eventually come full circle, because people will actually crave that the kind of experience of being at a good live gig. They do now, they always have done, and I think as music becomes a bit more ubiquitous, it's everywhere, it's on the bus, it's on the tube, it's in the hairdressers, it's in the pub. That's good in one respect, but also, you could argue it's devalued music. I think that value of a live performance will always exist. That's my belief. So.
Going back, I think it's content, live music as a part to play, going back to what the Professor Huber was saying. It's going to be like having the pizza at home, but you have to go out and to enjoy the experience of going to a good restaurant.
I think if in 10 years' time, it will be more to do with the way that we consume music as opposed to what the music actually is. Because we are so focused on technology, and any time you see a person by themselves, give them 10 seconds and they'll look at their smartphone. That's the reality of what humans are like these days. We're all zombies. It's horrible. And people are more bothered about what kind of smartphone they've got than and what app they're listening to and what music's actually on there. So I think musicians out there, create a really cool way for people to experience music. That will make you $1 billion.
I think for me, it's I think music's becoming a bit of a wallpaper, really, for society. I think for 10 years' time, I think it's going to come down to experience and connection with an audience, really, that live music experience and connection.
Yeah, I think we're at a really interesting point where we're probably all music lovers. We might pay our £10 a month for subscription services, but most people aren't like that. Most people just occasionally listen to a track. Maybe the future of kind of earning money is through lumping it in with things like Amazon Prime, that doesn't have the whole catalogue of entire music around the world. It's part of a package, and a bit of that percentage goes to kind of songwriters. It's kind of interesting times.
Thank you. Tommy, probably I need to finish now, yes?
Yes, it's lunchtime.
Yes. So thank you very much to all our panelists, and thank you, the audience, for coming.
I don't know.